All right, hello, hello, hello. I'm Johnny Jungle Guts, the top notch gamer, aka the top notch gamer. And today on the show, I'm interviewing artist, icon of OKCupid, legend of dating apps, Kristin Smallwood. Thanks so much for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Now, Kristin, you just recently moved to LA, but you grew up here.
Mm-hmm.
In Thousand Oaks?
In Camarillo.
Camarillo. What was that? What is that neighborhood like? I don't know anything about it.
It's very middle class, mostly. There weren't really any homeless people around there growing up.
Sure.
But there's a lot more now, apparently. I saw the first one ever recently, but they're there.
In Camarillo?
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a similar childhood experience because I grew up in, like, you know, upper middle class, tiny little suburban Republican country club type town in New Jersey. And then I went to Quaker boarding school for high school, so I was never really confronted with the reality of homelessness at all in my childhood. And now it's like, now, you know, you're just so aware of it living in the city.
Yeah.
I
guess that Camarillo is kind of like a little bit of a combination between sort of like Ventura, Oxnard, and Thousand Oaks kind of all together. Because I would say like Oxnard is a little bit like people that don't make as much money, but Ventura still is like people with money, but also middle class. And then Thousand Oaks is ridiculously rich people mostly.
Right.
Gated communities.
That was my understanding of Thousand Oaks. And you're working at Mocha, but you're also doing part-time Uber driving.
Mm-hmm.
You're, I think, the first friend of mine who's driven for Uber. How has that experience been?
Mostly good. I haven't had anybody really bad yet.
Yeah.
But I've had a few rowdy people. The first rowdy guys that I had were at 2 p.m. on a Sunday. And they
unexpected time.
They were already drunk. They were going from Simi Valley to Ventura for a Tech N9ne show.
Oh, boy. what's Tech N9ne's? Rappers?
Some kind of rap. And it was an hour-long drive also.
Oh, so you had to really get in there and deal with them for a while. That
yeah.
sucks. But it was an hour-long drive, so you probably got paid. Okay.
Yeah, I made a good amount of money. Yeah.
Now, you also, though, just before you moved, you had a big art show in New York.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk a little bit about that. I didn't get to see it, but I got to read a lot about it and see a lot of photos from it.
Yeah.
First, let's talk about the floor. What was going on the floor?
It was all pictures of women, mostly from magazines, but also some friends of mine, like people that I was sort of acquainted with, that let me use their pictures, but only women. And in the magazines, I also tried to cut out the men, but I used fashion magazines and also a lot of porn, mostly Playboy.
Yeah.
Like vintage ones. And
sure.
Then even there were even some little girls in it. I got like a kids magazine, a lot of brides. And then I also had a lot of photos of myself because I used to have this photo booth job in New York pretty much the whole time I was there for like 4 years. It was freelance, but I would save all the test photos of mine.
Oh, right.
So
yeah.
It worked out for that.
That's cool. And where'd you get all these magazines?
eBay, and then I wish I could remember the name of this place. It was some place in what is it called? I think it's called The Thing in Greenpoint. And they have a lot of vintage stuff, but I should have just gotten them in the first place because you can get a lot of magazines there, especially Playboy.
Uh-huh.
But the point of the floor was so that when people were there that they had to walk on women.
Okay. What's that sort of a metaphor for you, or what is that sort of addressing, do you think?
People walking on women, and also how it starts at, like, a young age, so that's why I included, like, little girls.
Yeah.
And even a photo of me as a little girl, too.
Sure. Sure. And then let's get into what was some of the installation.
Mm-hmm.
It's video, right?
Yeah, video, sculpture, and paintings. And, yeah, that's it.
And what was the video of?
I know.
But...
Well, there were two videos. There was one that was me lip-singing along to, God, what song is it?
It's I Will Always Love You.
Yeah, I will Always Love You by Whitney Houston with a superimposed vagina on my face. Yeah. I shot the whole thing in Snapchat, so it was all 10-second clips, and then I had to put them together.
Okay.
That was hard. I actually had to do that twice, too.
Because Snapchat, you could do the filter? Is that why?
Yeah. So it would just, like, put it on my face, but Snapchat only does 10-second videos, so...
Right.
I had to kind of, like, hold... I was holding the camera the whole time and, like... holding down the button to record, and then I started editing it. I didn't like it, and then I had to reshoot it.
It must have been hard to time up all those 10-second clips, right?
Yeah, that's because, like, the first time I shot it, then I realized how I should record it, which was basically to do, like, a line at a time. That made it a lot easier. Mm-hmm. But then I had another video, too, that was basically we did this... video shoot of me and my in this sexy baby costume that I like to wear for Halloween.
Yeah, it's your big Halloween look.
Yeah, and it was mostly just shots of that. There was also like a baby bottle bukkake scene where people were it was like bukkake but with baby bottles where they squirt milk on my face.
Sure.
And that the main thing though with that video was the audio, which was basically a breakup between a guy that I used to see that was a real
like
shithead.
Like a phone breakup that you did?
No, it was in person. I secretly recorded it.
Wow. So did he find out about that?
In the recording, I was recording it originally as evidence if I felt like telling his girlfriend about us.
Okay, so he was, yeah, okay.
He had seen me for like a year and then in the middle of it, he got a girlfriend but wasn't very like upfront about it. And I was maybe kind of trying to deny it for a while. But then he thought that basically we were going to have a conversation about how we need to be like more careful and stuff like that. And I confronted him about how he was never open about that. He used to refer to her as his roommate.
They were living together.
Yeah. She basically just like suddenly moved in. It was really weird. Because also I had also been seeing him for longer than her.
Right.
And then he even like took her to my work before and brought her by one time.
Oh, that's not good.
Yeah. So I recorded that as evidence and then it wound up, well, first it was actually in a sound piece I did at a gallery here for a show, this gallery Ashes on Ashes. And then, I shortened it a little bit. It's a little different from what was in that show. And,
sure.
And then I pitch shift I pitch shift both of our voices. I tried to just do his, but he talks over me like the whole time. So
yeah.
I had to do both.
There you go. Well, that's very dramatic. Now, what else, what were some of the sculptures and paintings?
The paintings were, I wanted to do 4 paintings, but then I couldn't because I was in the hospital, the show opened.
Let's talk about that a little bit.
Do you want to just go into that?
Yeah, sure. Let's just, so what happened? Because you were like at death's door almost right before your big art show.
Yeah, I was working on the show and then, one day I was feeling kind of sick after I had been there all day because I was really working hard, mostly on the floor. It was taking a long time.
Yeah, that happens a lot, I find, when you don't, you know, you don't think about workspace and then you
end up. And then it's a lot. I think I would have been able to, like, do everything that I needed to do if I hadn't gotten sick. But then I went home. I had, like, a fever. I think it went away in the morning. But then I had this abdominal pain.
Yeah.
And then I even went out that day to, like, Union Square. And then when I walked up the stairs from the train station, I had to stop and, like, stand on the side to catch my breath because I couldn't really breathe when I would walk up the stairs.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know why, like, my abdomen hurt so much, and then I worked on the show later that day more. I went home. I had another fever. I took, like, ibuprofen. Kind of made the pain go away, and then at 6 in the morning, I woke up with so much pain that I couldn't go back to sleep. I called my mom, and I wound up throwing up while I was on the phone with her, and it was so painful that I was, like, screaming. And then when I told her that I couldn't stand up totally straight, she told me that I needed to go to the ER.
Yeah.
And it turned out that I had a really bad UTI that had spread to my kidneys. And then I don't really know, like, the timing of it all, but at some point then I had viral and bacterial pneumonia, and the pneumonia was in my blood or something.
Wow. Wow. I didn't even know those. Pneumonia can go in your blood?
I guess. It's called something else.
Sepsis? Is that what it's called?
I'm a little confused about everything because the hospital I went to sucked. But they said that I didn't have sepsis, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I was there, though, for 10 days, and the first night I was there, I got a fever of, like, 104.5, and they had to cover me in ice. I was throwing up. I thought I was going to die. I called my mom, and then even when that was going on, they were taking my blood pressure, and every time that they tried to do it, the armband would rip off of my arm.
Why was that?
I don't really know how that all works, but because of me, like, freaking out, my blood pressure being so high that the armband just couldn't stay on. It would, like, fill up with air and then just rip off.
Weird. Oh, that sucks. And then how long were you in the hospital for?
10 days.
That's such a long time to be in the hospital. I've never been in the hospital that long.
Me neither. and even, like, maybe, like, 4 days in, someone came to visit me, and right before they showed up, I was feeling sick. I started throwing up. I went in the bathroom, and when I was in the bathroom, my lips were white. I opened the door, and I was like, oh, hey, sorry, I'm, like, throwing up, and then I was shivering, like, uncontrollably for, like, an hour, and they were, like, giving me more... The guy that came was giving me more blankets, but the nurses weren't really doing much, but...
Wow.
I got another 104 fever when that happened.
Sure. You got 104 fever just from going to the bathroom?
No, it was the infection. It was my body trying to fight off the infection. That's why it happened.
All right, here. Don't mind me. I'm sorry. We're talking about something very serious. But I just want to look up this little factoid about the game because I thought I had an item that I don't have. This is the fun of playing Final Fantasy while doing an interview. There's always these...
little things that come up?
These funny, awkward pauses where I have to figure out. Okay. Oh, hate this. When there's ad pop-ups on the phone. All right, because we're looking for Excalibur. It can be bought in the Jador auction house for okay, so first I have to go there. That's what I need to do. Hopefully I can do that. So it's so crazy though that this happened right around the time of your big show.
Yeah, so I missed the opening.
You did?
Yeah. I was still in the hospital. If I had left, then there would have been a chance that my insurance or whatever wouldn't have paid for it. I actually got the bill recently. I didn't have to pay it, but basically the hospital stay was just over $51,000.
And so you didn't get to go to the opening. So then what happens? Like, who went to the opening? Who was there?
I'm not sure. I know, like, some friends were there. I heard that there was a good amount of people. Another thing that I heard from the guys at the gallery was that basically, like, at openings, usually people go there and they look at the work and they don't really talk about it. They just socialize after. But I heard that they were actually talking about the work, like, after looking at it and socializing, but it wasn't just general socializing, it was actually talking about what was there, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
They kind of wanted to maybe have, like, a closing party, but I was in the middle of moving out here and, like, dealing with that stuff, and also the gallery that it was at, American Medium, they kind of have a mosquito problem, and I really hate mosquitoes, so I didn't want to do it.
Wow. So this show is, like, very fraught with accidents, so you were finished installing it when you went to the hospital, essentially?
No, I wasn't. They had to finish it for me.
Oh, well, that was nice of them, but
yeah.
What else did they have to do on their end?
They finished the floor for me, and then they had to hang a lot of the things. I was kind of there to... We pretty much, like, planned out where to hang some of it, but then there was, like, a technical difficulty with one of the sculptures, and because there were still two more, like, paintings that I wanted to make, which would have been easy to make for what I was planning on, they were like, oh, we can make them for you, but in the end, when I was there, I couldn't draw a sketch and have them do it the way I wanted. And then also there was, like, this wall text that I had them write, and they didn't really do it the way that I would have done it, but it's fine.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was definitely a grace under fire situation.
Yeah.
And so, but then, in spite of all of these issues that came up, there was still some exciting, I thought, press Joanna Fateman from La Tigra,
yeah,
and I'm sure many other things, wrote about it for Art Forum. Am I correct?
Yep.
So how did that happen for you? You just didn't even know it was happening, and then it happened.
I did know it was happening. She wanted to. They were texting me like while I was in the hospital, and they said that she wanted to come by. It was like a day or two after I had been in the hospital, maybe like the day after I first got admitted. But it was, oh, I remember, the show got postponed for a week. That's what happened. A little less than a week.
But you still were in the hospital.
Yeah, yeah. So it got postponed by like 6 days. And it was supposed to open on a Friday, and instead it opened the next Thursday. I forget how many days they had her wait, but she came by on another date to see it when they had everything like ready, basically.
Yeah, uh-huh.
So yeah, I don't know how she came across it. I know that she was actually following me on Instagram, so I think she might have been following me on Instagram before she went to see it.
Sure.
I'm not sure.
There you go. Well, that's very exciting. And then a couple of the places wrote about it.
And there's actually one more interview that I think is supposed to happen.
Oh, cool.
I interviewed, but I haven't,
It hasn't happened yet.
Yeah.
That's cool. But it was obviously a very non-commercial show.
Yeah.
In a way.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of those works are hard to sell, you know, insulation.
Oh, nothing sold.
Yeah. An insulation on the floor video, yeah, you know.
Well, I figured that the floor would never sell, but it's, and like some of the sculptures, I was hoping that the paintings would, but those didn't.
Yeah. And what other kind of stuff do they show over there at American Medium?
Like, what do they show generally?
Yeah, like, do they do a lot of, like, sort of, like, non-traditional
I think
stuff?
A little bit, yeah. But then also, like, some traditional things. Do you know Anne Hirsch? She lives here now.
You know, I know her that, I know that she exists on Twitter.
Oh.
And is popular on Twitter, I think.
And do you know about her, like, being on that show Frank the Entertainer in a Basement Affair?
No, I've never heard of that.
Oh, it's a, Flavor of Love. Then there was I Love New York.
Yeah.
And then Frank the Entertainer, who was on I Love New York, he had a spinoff show called Frank the Entertainer in a Basement Affair. And Anne was on it for an art project, but as, like, a person.
She was pretending, kind of, to be someone else?
Yeah, but she was upfront about being an artist, but she was pretending like she was there for Frank.
Right, but she was really just there for the...
Yeah,
for the...
that's actually how I originally knew of her, because my friend and I would watch that show, and my friend was like, I think that she's faking, and I was like, no way, she's real.
What was she doing on the show that was so outrageous?
She's just, like, weird. She's a weird person, and I think she was being a little bit, like, weirder. I don't know. My friend could just tell that she was, like, a performance artist, but I refused to believe it. But she got really far on it. She got, like, 7 episodes in or something.
Wow, yeah. And
she kissed him.
Wow, Frank.
Oh, yeah, so they actually, that gallery, American Medium, I think they represent her. So
sure.
She's a performance artist, though, but also does, like, paintings and other things.
Now, see, my conception of New York, like, it seems like because property values are so high and the rent is so high, it's kind of harder nowadays maybe to do more sort of, like, experimental or conceptual work. Would you say that's true? Because more galleries maybe want to show things that they can sell?
It kind of depends, I guess, if you're someone doing that and you don't care about... I mean, who buys that stuff? Nobody buys that, really, I feel like. Performances?
No.
Really.
Nobody buys that. You're not going to make it. You're going to have to write grants to survive.
I feel like also, I wasn't really in touch with, like, the art world out there that much.
In New York?
Yeah, like, I don't know. I didn't really ever go to openings for the most part.
Okay.
I was kind of, like, low-key... out of place involved in a way or whatever. Like, I chose who I would be involved with, but I wasn't involved in it in a bigger way where I could really say what the art scene is like out there, except that I think that a lot of it is just all about, like, social connections and bullshit.
Yeah.
Which is kind of why I wasn't involved with it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I mean, that's true out here too.
Yeah.
But I feel like I just hear, you know, friends of mine who like graduated from like the like painting program at Yale still having a really hard time showing, you know?
Mm.
And that's so weird because I find here in LA, really, it's not that difficult to show.
Yeah, I want to have a painting show now that I've come up with, but it'll probably take me a while to really, like, make anything for that. So I'm not ready to actually have that. But I don't know how I would go about even getting a space for that.
Sure. Sure. Now, you're also well known for your, and we could probably talk about this forever, your, like, insane interactions that you have with people on dating apps.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, I think OKCupid and maybe Tinder. I don't really know.
It's mostly OKCupid.
OKCupid.
Yeah.
Let's talk about, like, because you post a lot of screen grabs from those interactions
mm-hmm.
on Instagram.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that project, how long you've been doing that, and just why you think, like... Because you have just, I don't know, it just seems like so many miraculously insane interactions have occurred.
I don't know, it seems to also be mostly just, like, the New York guys. Although I have gotten a few out here that are ridiculous, but I got way more, like, crazy messages in New York.
I mean, the most iconic, I can't even think of all of them, because there's so many iconic ones. My personal favorite was the guy who, you know, was trying to entice you into some kind of romantic interlude, not only by letting you know that he was going to eat your pussy till you came, but also because he had hard meth.
Oh, and, that guy.
And Xanax, which I think he was trying to write Xanax.
Yeah, and he was also saying that he had meth trees.
Meth trees. I think he just maybe didn't put...
I think he meant meth and weed.
Yeah, yeah. But he didn't put the, you know...
Comma.
He made a little mistake.
Yeah. And he came back around a couple times on, like, different profiles and was very pushy.
Wow, yeah. Now, what I'm curious about, honestly, is what... Does your profile have any sort of more... Like, what does your profile look like?
I recently deleted it, but I've had a couple of different ones. All of my pictures were really crazy. I mean, they're of me. They're, like, funny. They're not, like, serious-looking, though.
Yeah.
They're weird. They kind of scare some guys.
Sure. That's the impression that I get sometimes.
Yeah. And then, like, for example, there was a picture of me with my friend Jake where it was for Clump TV that Colin Sulf did, like, part of a video shoot he did with that. And we had the most insane makeup on our faces. Like, my face is basically yellow with, like, a lot of black going on. And then Jake is next to me in, like, a really short, like, mushroom cut wig, basically. With
I think I know.
Just
I think
as, I... like, the same kind of insane makeup.
Yeah.
And then also I had one where if you've ever seen that app, like Perfect 360, I think it's called. It's like a makeup app.
Yeah.
And you can like even make your eyes really white. So I had one of those where like the makeup is just like super insane. And then I made like the fake lipstick go outside of my lip line really far. But I had a couple different profiles in the content of what I would write. In the past, I had ones where, like, I would play, like, I was, like, a 9-to-5 office worker.
Sure.
And then I would mostly respond to messages at that time, like, I was an idiot.
Yeah.
and then I had ones that were kind of, like, more like me conveying my personality, but, like, with a lot of sarcasm. It just kind of depended. They changed a lot.
Yeah, because here's my question. There seem to be a lot of guys who are maybe interested in, like, having you, like, piss or shit on them. was there any motivation behind that, or that was just, like, a weird thing?
I don't really think that there was any thing on my profile about that.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of it. I have peed on a guy before, but I don't think that I mentioned anything like that.
You didn't mention on that, yeah.
No. And I also used to wet the bed for a really long time when I was a kid, but I know that I didn't put anything in there about that.
So it was completely unrelated.
Yeah. Which is funny, too, because even, I don't know if I posted this guy or not, but recently in California, there was a guy that had, oh, his profile name was like Scatman something.
Oh boy.
And at first, before I read the message, I honestly thought that it was like related to the Scatman.
Yeah, like,
but of course it wasn't.
Yeah.
I think I just told him that he was gross.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. There's so many great ones.
But it's also funny because there's some other people that do those screenshots too, and there was one earlier today, this girl that I follow, and she's in New York, and she posted one from a guy where he offered her $750, like, to sleep with him, and he's like, I know you're not a whore or anything, though. And I was like, this is, like, what...
How much money did he offer?
$750,
okay.
I feel like I've gotten a similar amount, too. I wonder if it's the same guy.
I mean, you don't
want to... The same guys would message us, too.
You don't want to do less than $400, really, is what I remember one time I was talking to my therapist, and I was saying, you know, these apps are so gross. The other day, a guy offered to pay me for sex, and my therapist said, how much did he offer you? And I said, I think he offered me like $50. And my therapist was like, never do it for less than $400.
Oh, that's good.
I thought that was a really amazing moment. I was so shocked that my therapist respond that way. But he's a older gay man. He's seen a lot of different things.
Yeah, and I'm sure that he's talked to a lot of people about that kind of stuff too.
Okay, here I'm pulling up some of these old messages. Hi, beautiful. If you could do one thing, anything in the world, what would it be?
Change society into a matriarchy. You, and then he didn't respond. So I said, too real for you.
There's like, what are you think are the most outrageous that you've seen though? Like what ones really blew, really were unbelievable?
There was the guy that he said, and it was actually in my press release for the show. He said something like, it's hard for me to remember because I just had a little bit of alcohol. it's the one about like the fantasy and he thought I was into like a rape fantasy.
Yeah.
And he didn't understand what rape culture is.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I forget what that
So
that
you like sort of tried to explain
Well,
it
I did
to
wind
him.
Up explaining it to him, but that wasn't in the screenshot. But the most ridiculous one I ever got was this crazy guy, and I have another story about him too, but basically, like, he was kind of cute, so I was sort of interested, but then he got nasty with me and talked about, like, something sexual, and I, like, kind of blew him off with that, and he seemed to get offended, and then he started fighting with me, and then at the end of the conversation, he said, you deserve to be raped by a black guy, but not that word.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
And that was the craziest message I've ever gotten. But then I also saw I think it was right before I moved or right after I moved, a friend of mine shared something on Facebook about,
yeah, here it is. I think we should maybe share some similar fantasies. Fantasies? You mentioned something about rape culture, or did I misinterpret that?
Yeah. And that really blew up. People couldn't believe that. A girl that I follow actually on Instagram, she reposted that and it got a lot of attention.
Yeah.
But anyway, that guy, he worked at some restaurant in Rockaway Beach. And so my friend, his friend had gone there and then posted a negative Yelp review about the place.
Uh-huh.
And then that guy that messaged me the thing about me, how I deserve to get raped. He found this guy who'd left the Yelp review and found his Facebook and sent him a lot of mean messages, like calling him a faggot and all this stuff. And so then I saw screenshots from that and I was like, oh my God, that is that guy that said that. And then I found the screenshots from him messaging me on OKCupid and I posted them. But then it all ended up getting deleted by Facebook.
Wow. Here's a good one. Here, I'll be the guy, you be the girl.
Okay.
Sexy ass.
I bet your balls are huge and very saggy.
I want to smack that ass and pull your hair.
I want to grab your balls and rip them off.
It's amazing that they keep talking to you after these interactions. You kind of remind me of like a sort of like a Karen Finley type personality on OKCupid. but obviously it's very provoked. Sometimes, now here's my question, because there was a time, the time has passed, but there was a time where I actually felt a little bad for these idiots, like, that they were getting put on blast.
Yeah.
But now I've kind of just realized that who cares?
I mean,
their names aren't in it anyway. So there's no way
the pictures are, but
they're so small. Yeah, you can never know.
But that's the thing is, and I've had a couple of people be like over the years be like, you should make a book, and I kind of want to do that if it is even still really relevant. But if I did that, I would change the pictures.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or just have, you could even just have, like, a template that you could create.
Well,
somehow.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, because it's just, like, the round shape, and I would just, I don't know what I would do, but I would put something else in it. Like, I was thinking about images that would go with, like, the conversation or something.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I wouldn't, like, publish them on there, but on my own, like, personal Instagram, I don't think that that's a big deal.
Sure. It's certainly not.
Yeah.
And they're...
I mean, you're putting yourself online and putting yourself out there if you really don't want somebody to be putting those screenshots out in the public view, then you shouldn't be saying that shit in the first place.
Yeah, you really shouldn't. And it's so amazing that they do. I mean, I just think, you know, but oh, it's just mind-blowing, really, the stuff that people say. Let's talk about the baby costume. Where did that come from?
Yandy.com.
Oh, Yandy.com.
It's the slutty costume site.
Oh, I've never been to that.
Oh, you should go on it. They have, like, sexy corn, stuff like that.
Wow.
But then they have a lot of, like, stereotypical, like, sexy bank robber and shit like that.
Yeah.
But years ago, I don't remember how, but I saw the sexy baby costume, and I got that. And then I wore it, for stuff other than Halloween, and then I wore it, like, 3 or 4 years in a row for Halloween.
Yeah.
But then it developed a little bit, like, the past 2 years I was a sexy baby on acid, and I was...
Not literally or literally?
Literally.
Oh, wow, okay.
And then, last year when I did it, I blacked out my teeth, so I was, like, a toothless sexy baby on acid.
There you go.
Well, one of the best things, too, last year was, I was riding the L train into Brooklyn, and at some point, so I was dressed as the sexy baby on acid. I had just taken the acid tab like 30, 45 minutes before then. And then a like 4-year-old little girl dressed as a fairy princess was sitting next to me.
Yeah.
But I wish that somebody could have been there to take our picture because I was on the train alone. And then there were some people that were creeped out by my missing, like, blacked out teeth, but I turned and I smiled at her and she laughed and, like, enjoyed me.
Yeah.
She was not scared.
That's pretty good.
But then it was also funny because then I went to a party later and a few people were like, whoa, they're like, you're scary.
Where was the party?
Secret Project Robot in Brooklyn.
Now let's talk about that space because I hear a lot about that space out here in LA doing a lot of different interesting things, but I don't really know exactly, I don't know very much about it.
They just closed.
Well, that's horrible.
Yeah, but they're opening up a new space. I don't know much about that, but I think that they started in like, maybe like 2005 or something like that in Williamsburg, and they were in that space for a while, and then... And then they moved to another one in Bushwick, but they were like art and band practice studios. But then they also had a stage for music shows, and then they would also do like art shows. And they had an indoor bar and an outdoor bar, so they would do big parties. And the same owners also opened up this bar, Happy Fun Hideaway, in Bushwick.
That I've also heard of, yeah.
Yeah, and then they also own a coffee shop, too, called Flowers for All Occasions. Then they had all three of those going on, but now they're going to open up a new space. I heard a little bit about it, and I think it's going to be like... 2 or 3 stories and like Secret Project Robot, but like bigger.
Sure.
I think that they had to close the space because, I know that they were always having trouble with the liquor license because if they wanted a liquor license, they had to pay for 2 lots for it because of how big the space was. Cause they had the indoor bar and then an outdoor space and the city or whatever considered it to be 2 lots and not 1 place.
But they were only paying for 1 somehow?
I'm not sure what they were doing, but liquor licenses in New York are really expensive, so they couldn't afford to have both.
Yes.
So I think that they couldn't afford their rent anymore, maybe, which is why they closed.
Was that where they had, was it at Secret Project Robot? Was that where they had the pornography festival?
That was where the first year porn festival was.
Oh, but then it blew up. And you were tangentially involved in that, right? You were in one of the films.
Yes, and then actually I was in one of the films the first year, and then this year was the second year, and I did a poetry reading.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Now, what were you doing in, what was the film you were in, and what were you doing in it?
I was in Jake Deibler's horror porn.
All right.
And I did a scene where it was like fake, but I sucked a guy's dick and ripped the skin off of his dick, and then he shoves my head down on his dick, and then I bite it off. Or something. I bite it off.
Wait, but skinless dick?
My teeth get knocked out. Maybe I don't bite the dick off. No, I just skin
How do your
it.
Teeth get knocked out?
Because he shoves my head down on it.
So hard?
Yeah.
But it's a skinless, bloody dick at this point?
It's not skinless.
You just rip some
it
of the skin
It happens really
off.
Fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I really just, like, puncture it.
Okay. All right. And then what happens? That's your
That's
whole
pretty much the end of that.
But why isn't there then? Is there some part of that where there's like a prosthetic head of you that exists?
Yeah, that's
somewhere.
Why. That's how the teeth get knocked out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, when he shoves my head down, it's a fake head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go.
And then there's two other scenes in that movie too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But it was all supposed to be kind of scary and.
It was all horror porn.
Definitely not sexy.
Yeah.
I mean, you can never put a stamp on something and say it's definitely not going to be sexy, but... And then, at the second one, you read some poems. What were some of those?
They were all from this website called penisplugsablaze.com, which is, this site by this guy that's really into sounding.
Oh, yeah.
And,
For those of you on the internet who don't know, sounding is when you put metal rods up your, penis.
Your urethra.
Yeah.
So he makes these, like, the sounding equipment. I found his website years ago. I don't even remember how. Like, in 2010 or something like that.
Yeah.
And so he makes the metal rods, like, out of stainless steel. They're really artistic and cool. And then he has these pages of poetry, which I don't even know if you can find them really if you just go on the site now, but they are online still. And the poems, some of them are love poems to the sounding devices he makes.
Yeah.
And then some of them are hate poems to these two women, I guess, that were taking the pictures of his sounding equipment and selling knockoffs to people. So I read like I don't know how many. I read a few of those poems.
Great.
Like 30 minutes with pictures projected behind me in a PowerPoint presentation.
So a whole audio, you know, multimedia.
Yeah.
Moment.
And then at the end, I played a video of a woman doing some sounding from Pornhub.
It's not for the faint of
No, people were disturbed.
I don't think I've ever actually watched it. But it is important to, if you are going to do sounding, to do it with the appropriate instruments, the sounding rods, because if you do it with anything else, you're going to get an infection.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what some of his poetry is about.
Yeah.
I've never done that with anybody. I just find it really fascinating.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely a very extreme thing, but it's also interesting to think of the penis as being a penetrant, penetrable organ.
Yeah, and he makes ones that also go both ways.
like what do you two, mean?
Kind of like docking or whatever. Like
oh, like you could have two dicks and they would be both up a sounding rod touching each other.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Oh my god.
And then sounding rods with holes in them like that. So then you can. So then one guy will like come in the other guy's dick.
I think I have an idea of what you're talking about, but that is a lot.
Yeah.
It's like a hole with a funnel or something?
It's like the stainless steel sounding rod and it's hollow inside, so you put one in one dick and then put one in the other, and then...
In the other dick.
Yeah, so both of them have the rod, and the same rod, and two guys have the same rod in their dicks, and they both have holes in it. Yeah, and then one of them comes, and then his cum shoots through the rod and goes into the other guy's dick.
So you can masturbate while the rod is inside the penis. It's okay to do that.
Yeah.
To really get in there and stroke the penis. That's amazing. Like, I didn't even know. Now here's my question: Did the guy know that you were reading his work?
No.
Well, what's his name?
I don't know. I don't really know much about him. There isn't. I guess I could have tried to contact him. I feel like he could maybe be angry about it, but I feel like if anything,
he probably doesn't even know about it.
Well, he definitely doesn't know about it. But I mean, if he did know, maybe he wouldn't like it. But at the same time, I'm actually like getting the word out about him.
Yeah. Well, I think everyone. What's the name of the website?
PenisPlugsAblaze.com.
Okay, so everyone should go there and check out some of this guy's fascinating. Work in body modification.
I think he also has some salt and pepper grinders or shakers on there for sale, too.
In the shapes of penises?
They're cool. They might have been on Etsy, but no, they're like regular ones. They're nice, though.
Because how do you make the rods? Like, what? I don't know.
I have no idea.
Same manner of constructing a sounding rod, you can use the same equipment to make other things
like a salt and pepper shaker. I think so.
Wow.
Oh yeah, because he also has like a stainless steel rosary too.
Well, for some very reason. Spiritual.
Yeah.
That's a recurring trope in sexuality though, the Christian imagery and sexual you know, the Catholic schoolgirl thing. I guess it's all sort of based on the forbidden, right? You know.
Yeah.
That you're not supposed to be. So that makes it more erotic, and it's true that when you're doing something you think you're not supposed to be, it's very exciting. Well, do you have any projects coming up?
Nothing. No, like solid anything. But I have an idea. Should I talk about it?
I've heard conflicting advice on whether to talk about your what you have in the works. But also, how many people have really listened to this show? Like, maybe we'll get 100 listens.
I think you might have seen some stuff that I posted the other day about the concept of of this business that I came up with that is a art gallery, spa retreat.
Oh yeah, Spaghetti.
Yeah, an Italian restaurant called Spaghetti, like the Getty Museum.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm thinking about making a painting show that is called Spaghetti.
Set in the world of Spaghetti.
Yeah, that would be basically the concept of the first art show at Spaghetti. But so I was thinking about making small paintings. The only one that I've really come up with so far is a woman with like a face mask, like cleansing mask, and then with bruschetta on her eyes instead of cucumbers. And then I want to make all the frames out of Tuscan themed like home design shit.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Now another, while you were talking about that, to backtrack a little bit, another messenger person that you encountered on OKCupid, who I found absolutely riveting, was the man who had a fetish for people knocking on doors.
Oh my god, I forgot about that guy.
That guy was a treasure.
Oh yeah.
It was almost poetic, the conversation you guys had back and forth.
Yeah.
Because he was like wanting to know how hard you knocked on a door, and then you were very nice and told him that I don't remember what he said, but it was just this very back and forth about the kind of door knocking that he liked and the kind of door knocking you did and the different kind of door knockers.
It was basically this sort of like, for me, very bland conversation, but I could tell that it was getting him off, and it wasn't like my intention, but it was so incredible that I had to play along with it.
Yeah, it was riveting, really. I had a similar, I did a video once where I was singing while getting my hair cut at the barber, and a lot of the comments on that video are questions about, you know, is there a final picture of your haircut? Did the other guy who was playing the guitar get his hair cut?
And I went to the YouTube pages of the men who were leaving those comments, and they all seemed to have a sort of fetish for guys getting high and tight military style haircuts, which at first I was like, oh, that's, you know, weird. That's not why I did the video. And then I slowly realized that I really do enjoy a haircut, not in a extreme, you know, exactly sexual way, but it really does it for me sort of emotionally.
I feel like a lot of people enjoy getting their hair cut.
Do you?
I do for the most part, but the one thing I don't enjoy is trying to find a place that is reasonably priced that you cut like. My hair right. Yeah.
Yeah, I've really lucked out with that for the past 5 years. I've been going to the same sort of barber's place, and so
I think a problem is that women's haircuts are generally more expensive than men's.
I wouldn't know, but I'm sure you're right. Yeah. I mean, you're right.
I can't really find anything for under $40.
No way. Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I pay like $12, $14
for my haircut. Yeah, I'm seeking something under $40, but I even called a place the other day because I thought maybe in Camarillo they would be cheaper. I called this place. I was like, how much do you charge for a layered trim? And the girl was like, we start at $35, but then when you come in, we'll determine how much it is based on your length and stuff.
Wow.
So it's like $35 is already kind of like my limit. So if you're going to go up from there, forget it.
Yeah, yeah, that's pretty wild.
And I don't really want to go to a place and then you know, have it go up and waste my time going there.
You can't really, you know. I remember watching that show. I don't remember what it was called, but it was a hair cutting reality competition show. Do you remember that?
I know. Yeah, I do know what you're talking about. Actually, that like woman from New Zealand that was on it.
Tabitha.
Yeah, I saw her. I went. My friend took me to Hugo's the first time since I moved back. When I went to eat out here, and she was there filming something.
Yeah. My takeaway from that show was that women's hair was much, much more complicated than I had any idea it was, first of all. And second of all, was my favorite scenario from the show was they had a challenge where everyone had to cut hair using, like, non-traditional implements, like, and one of the girls had to do her haircut with a huge pair of hedge clippers.
Oh my god.
And so she won her hedge clipper haircut, won the challenge or whatever. So then she was like, that's gonna be my signature.
Oh no.
And so she had the hedge clippers in like a samurai sword sheath, and she would like pull them out like very dramatically and be like, here we go. And it was really funny to me.
So she was just like always doing that on the
show? She kept doing hedge clipper haircuts even when she didn't have to.
Wow, that's crazy.
As like a little signature piece. Yeah. And it was so funny to me.
Did it work out for her?
I don't think she won, but I think she certainly was, you know, I'm talking about her, so. I don't remember anyone else from the show. The only other part of that show I remember is they had to, like, put things in people's hair, and one person put, like, a treasure chest that, like, opened when they, like, pulled the hair.
Like, I kind of remember that show, but not enough.
It was pretty bad, but the hedge clippers was hilarious. It was just, like, the perfect combination of, like, the weirdness of reality television. Like, people understanding that, like, this is about more than just this competition. Obviously, only one person's gonna win, but you have to, like, make your mark. Even without winning, which is, I think, there's sort of a meta competition now that goes on in most reality, like Drag Race. You know, a lot of people aren't expecting to win, but they try to do other things just to make them more memorable, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show, Kristin.
Thank you.
And I'm so excited you moved to California because, you know, that's what we didn't really talk about is how we first got to know each other. Because you're really the first friend that I've ever been around in real life that I fully met on the internet.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I met you on Tumblr.
Yep.
Way back in...
probably 2009 or 10 or
something like that when I was still doing Tumblr. And it was funny because we had like a few, you know, connections I found out over the years, but...
But a lot of the people that I know from, like, here that you know, I also know from Tumblr.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because I was introduced to you through Tumblr by them.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways. So So yeah, so everyone follow Kristin on Instagram, the real boobs 420, and it's definitely one of my top Instagrams that I ever know of, and her Tumblr was great too. But I think you don't still do Tumblr, do you?
Not sometimes I post on it, but not really.
Not really. Tumblr is kind of
dead.
Well, I keep I don't know anyone who uses it really anymore, but other people, it seems to be still going on. Maybe it's just moved. Maybe we just
different direction.
Our community just wore it out. Like people we know just wore it out or something. I really don't know.
I don't know.
Anyway, stay tuned for more from Kristin, and stay tuned for more episodes of Let's Gay. We upload every week. Thanks so much.